Let me now come to you, Manish. So we have all during the day, we have seen the kind of new technologies Jinko has been bringing in terms of the, obviously, even in terms of the basic module size and the wattage, we have increased from the 230 odd levels now to the 325 level. Now, I just wanted to know again, I think though, given the space is evolving so fast and, so today we have a situation with around, let's say, 12 gigawatts of installed capacity. Some of the Indian projects which were, which were commissioned in the early phases, which were not really, at that time, still a lot of trying and testing was happening. People were still learning up the curve. Some of them may have used modules of the lesser watt per cat. So in terms of energy systems as a leading global, module manufacturer, I know introducing new systems is one part of it. I just wanted to have some of your views in terms of retrofitting. Have you seen some inquiries on that? What are the challenges for a module developer like you, manufacturer? Would you continue to, make some of the older kind of wattage range so that, if there is a replacement demand or a retrofitting demand that can be, that can be addressed there? How, how do you that, how do you fill that part?
Yeah, thanks for this question. Very interesting, actually. The fact is that, Indian government has certain regulations which doesn't allow a kind of a retrofitting into the existing solar installations. If I take you back to 2011, when Gujarat policy was there and people were installing, the installation size was, AC and DC is 1:1 ratio. They don't allow any addition in terms of DC because they were paying you 15 rupees tariff that time. People really installed any type of module there, whether it is CDDE or standard poly or mono. Today, when we see those installations, these installations are doing well. My colleague mentioned about the data which is available on Gujarat portals. But some of the installations are still not doing well. But there is no possibility that government would allow for retrofitting on those, because the nameplate capacity of the plant cannot be changed. So which means if you have installed a 100 watt peak module into so many numbers, you can at best change into that same watt peak capacity.
Agreed. So retrofitting, retrofitting no, but replacement yes. So for example, at today, let's say the plant has now already covered six years. Now you still have a 19 year PPA remaining. And assuming, analysis show that 5% of the module have been degraded to a unacceptable level, they have been some backsheet punches, whatever reason, let's say 5% of the modules now remain, now want replacement.
So to answer this question technically, every module degrades differently,
right?
If you have a different string, different type of current and voltage flowing through inverters, it degrades differently, and also because of the shading and other effects, right? Now what happens is when you go to installation, you cannot really pinpoint which 5% you have to replace first. So it can be a phased manner where you can pick and choose the most deteriorated or degraded modules first. You pick up those 5 or 10% modules, you have to pay today's cost to replace them, and then look at the next year or after that, the kind of plan. Definitely, a lot of people are doing this kind of O&M retrofitting, because they are now earning revenue from those projects and they have a capability to enhance the efficiencies of overall project site. But retrofitting is again limited within the government regulations and within those phased manner changes you can implement on those projects.
Akash, let me come to you. Once a developer like Adani, once cross a gigawatt kind of an installed kind of capacity, maybe you have projects spanning some 10 locations across, let's say, 8 states, something like that, right? Again, as part of the energy, so one of the things that, again, the focus in India so far has been only building greenfield assets, right? So we are only talking about the construction phase. What about on the spare side, what kind of strategies are required, with somebody with a 2 or 3 gigawatt capacity, do you need to look at a regional spare storing kind of a strategy, or will it remain to be plant specific kind of a strategy? How do you, any thoughts you want to share on that?
See, as far as modules are concerned, we ask each and every manufacturer to support us with some hot standby inventories. So it is actually asked during the in the contract itself while we are ordering for the project itself. And For the O&M, we definitely, for the BOS, we definitely recommend, for example, in this in a particular state, if you have a 10 locations, so you can, because the cost is, in the current scenario, the cost is a major thing, operation cost even, looking at the tariffs. So to reduce that cost, definitely centralized store kind of a situation will be a optimum thing to do. Because nowadays, like, the biddings are like 20 megawatt block in various 12 or 14 districts, something, that sort of thing. So it's better to have a centralized O&M store.
And typically this, the hot store, the hot inventory that you are asking the manufacturer, typically from the date of, let's say, shipment, etc., from the main shipment, till how much longer do they typically, keep it? What's the standard clause in the industry?
See, if manufacturing is having their storage in the India, so they will assure us that they will at least keep some prefixed number of pallets as a hot standby inventory for our plant.
Okay.
And if they don't have, then they will supply with the shipment itself.
Okay.
Current project. So I'll keep on the site as a inventory.
Just coming to you, Mayank, obviously, Huawei has taken a strategic call of focusing on string inverters. But again, I think if you look at majority of the installations still in the country, it's based on central inverters. So, just wondering, what are the key drivers that you are seeing towards adoption of string inverters vis-a-vis central? And are there any technological improvements which are happening on the central inverter side that you guys are carefully monitoring and you should be worried about?
So thank you, Danish, for asking such an interesting question. This question is asked to us when we entered in the India market, that how you're gonna approach the developers who are already having a set of mind doing the central inverter from such a long time. So same question is being asked in China around 3-4 years back in 2012. So when you have a very good business case and you have a right approach, you go meet the decision makers, work with them on logical basis, do the work, do the costing with them, help them to understand your new proposition. So what we have come up with, that the string with the multiple MPPT solution. So this provides the higher yield to the developers, more safe and reliable system, and less O&M cost. So when we sum up all these values factor, put it into a business model, and see the the cost comparison of everything, it makes business sense, business case. So that's how we were able to convince the Indian developers to come with us and do projects.
No, but just wondering, let's say for calendar year 2017, what would be the split in terms of gigawatt shipments of inverters in India by central type and by string type? What would you have that number? Because I would tend to believe it would still be skewed maybe in the ratio of 90-10 or maybe even further.
So the total installation as we see is around 8-9 gigawatt in this year, this financial year. So we did 2 gigawatt shipment to India. So rest is the central for utility.
Okay. So essentially nearly
excluding the rooftop.
Excluding the rooftop. Yeah. So nearly a 20% kind of a market share. Right. Okay, so let me. I think we'll just open the panel to some questions. But before I do that, I think couple of kind of hot topics. Where I would definitely want Vinay to give his view. Vinay, obviously your views, Bridge to India views on anti-dumping duty. And if yes, what should be the right amount of it? So that's point number one. And yeah, maybe you will go with that. Yeah.
That's a very tricky one, Danish. I think, to be honest, I think that's a very, very difficult decision for the Indian government, because they have to look after the interests of the solar and the renewable industry, but equally they have many other conflicting priorities, whether it is Make in India, job creation, economic impact, etc. So I think it's a really difficult decision. Clearly, on the strict technicality of the case, you have to give some incentives or some policy boost to domestic manufacturing. I think that is understandable. What we don't understand is why does that incentive have to come in the form of a trade barrier, you know, by way of additional duties. I mean, clearly, as I said, the industry has scaled up so significantly. The policy of, you know, this 100 gigawatt target has been known for more than 3 years now. Why hasn't Indian manufacturing scaled up? And I think the reasons for that are not just related to cost competitiveness, but I think there are more reasons about we don't have the technology, we don't have the ecosystem, and you know, we don't have the infrastructure or the ease of doing business, instead of creating trade barriers, which in our view are actually not going to result in any material boost to the domestic manufacturing sector, because the policy environment is always very volatile. And you know, as we have seen in other countries like, you know, US and many parts of Europe, trade barriers have not really resulted in any major addition to the domestic manufacturing sector. You know, what is going to happen in India? I think there's a lot of speculation. You know, we also feel that now that the US has made a decision, you know, that may have a minor bearing on how the Indian decision makers go about their investigation and process. I think, you know, there's a very strong, I would say, buzz in the industry, or there's a very strong sense in the industry that some level of duty is going to come, because I think, you know, the Indian government is not far too committed to the manufacturing sector. There's also a perception that, you know, even if a duty comes and the cost of solar goes up by 30, 40 or 50 paisa, solar will still remain one of the cheapest sources of power. So it's not going to do any major damage to solar in the long run. So I think, you know, if I look at that perspective and, you know, try to balance the needs of the solar sector and the need to avoid a disruption to the sector, you know, on balance, I would say maybe we are looking at a 15 to 20% duty barrier. You know, whether that is safeguard or anti-dumping duty, what is the time frame, I don't know. But I think that if a decision comes along in this band, then I won't be very surprised.
You know, I think very well put across. I think though that's, so that would be, you know, our view as well. I think though we have seen any which way, we have seen international module pricing being volatile. You know, you had a situation, you know, last year, once the Chinese feed-in tariff regime ended, the prices did fell through a roof. And obviously now over the last two quarters, because of tight supply constraints, they have gone up. So I think though, between a band of 10 to 15 odd percent, that's something which is business as usual for the solar developers also. They are used to seeing this much of price volatility, in a normal 12 month span any which way. So maybe, you know, that can definitely be absorbed. But yeah, I think you got to keep both sets of stakeholders honest. Yes, the Indian domestic manufacturing industry requires a boost, but not to a level where they become complacent, you know, in terms of, you know, really getting their act together and competing on a global scale. So it has to be a balance around that. And the last question that I'm going to put to our panel before we open to the panelists is, where do we see forget about anti-dumping, etc. Just international module prices. You know, what's your outlook, let's say, and let me put a time frame of, let's say, Q4 calendar year 2018. So where do you see module prices, you know, ranging around that
line? I think it's a very, very difficult question to predict future. I think only astrologers and magicians can do that. But I'll attempt to the best of my ability is that prices are, a denominator of the demand and supply. You know, it's a tricky situation. So as the demand is increasing globally, everybody is going for renewable. Yesterday at Davos, PM Modi also emphasized that, it is one of the concerns that, the global warming is the world is going through. So I think the focus and thrust on renewable will remain, and the demand of solar will ever increase. So it will create a kind of a demand always, and more the capacity we are putting up across the globe, including India, the demand is not going to recede. So prices, I think, are going to remain, I think, more or less stable for this full year, is my guess. Again, it is difficult to predict the impact of, US anti-dumping or impact of other, duties which India is thinking of imposing. But this is a kind of guess that we can make.
So interestingly, you can ask any executive, be it business development, be CEO, be it the R&D guys of any module manufacturer, They will never talk about the prices falling in the near future. And still, we have seen the kind of price falls that we have seen over the last decade or so. So great. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for sharing your views. We'll just open it to the panel. To the audience. If there is any question, please let please identify yourself and also identify if there any particular panelist that you are directing the question toward.
My name is Chandrasekhar. I'm from Jinko only. So my question is, everybody is talking about anti-dumping and safeguard duty, but in this whole scenario, we forget the major dispute regarding the ITHS code of solar panel, which is hitting around 8% of total duty structure. So what is your thought process to get rid of this particular problem?
Absolutely. I think there is no need to discuss this. I think it's quite a avoidable kind of a situation. If the government wants to protect the domestic manufacturers or wants to earn extra custom revenue, just come out with a gazette notification and clarify there is an 8% duty. I think this kind of uncertainty back behind the doors, finding ambiguity in law does not help anybody. It just causes more harassment at the ports, by the custom officials. It gives the assessing officer more discretion, which is always a source of corruption. I'm assuming nobody in the panel would have a dispute. If the intent is to earn custom revenues, please come out with a straight gazette notification that we want 8% duty. There's no point beating around the bush and hiding behind clothes, court reclassification.
So we have seen that the prices are falling down, even though they are increasing model price, but in terms of tariffs, still they are going down. So from a investment perspective, what kind of returns you expect on the projects which are going to happen now over the next 1 year? And in terms of the criteria which US Bank have in their criteria to select projects to lend. So what kind of criteria US Bank has in terms of quality, in terms of financial strength of the company which is asking for the financing? So what kind of criteria US Bank has to do lending for the projects?
Great. So let me tell you first of all about the cost of funds. I think if you talk about the equity side, where we see, and I'm just talking about the large grid connected reverse auction processes. I'm not talking about the private PPAs or the rooftop market. I think on the large grid connected reverse auction processes, we believe that today, on greenfield assets, developers are looking at anywhere between a 12 to a 14.5 kind of a percent kind of a range of a levered IRR or the equity IRR. In terms of cost of debt, today I think in the market for a project finance, for under construction finance, one can look at anywhere between somewhere around 9% to around 10.5-11% kind of all in cost of debt, depending again on on the various risk factors. I think in terms of project selection at Yes Bank or at any other lender, obviously first and foremost the sponsor's strength, his track record in terms of developing and commissioning projects in the past, the project structure itself, whether it's a state bid, NBV and SECI, all of them have various kind of risk factors. Tier one modules obviously is a kind of a given now. Tier one equipment, proper EPC contract, with the relevant warranties. And obviously, the most important part is obviously on the DSCR. So a lender's decision is essentially based on a DSCR number and how the project economics shape out. Yeah.
So I would like to add that the projects which are now being bidded, people are also started taking a different view to the IRRs. IRRs are mainly equity IRRs, and people look at them in two different ways nowadays. One is at the IRR you bid the project, and also there are segment of companies who are also looking at the numbers which they will make when they exit those projects. So there are segments of companies which are not going to last for 25 years of the project life, and they have a plan to exit in due course, 3 years, 5 years time frame, and they look at that exit premium also, they inbuilt into the IRR today, and they can bid more aggressively. So that's another segment coming up nowadays.
So one more question, so what kind of DSRs you actually these expect, maybe based on 9.5% cost of funding?
Again, yeah, it all depends upon project to project, sponsor to sponsor, what kind of recourse you have, etc. Mm-hmm. But a typical benchmark to be used is 1.2 DSCR at a P90 kind of a generation level.
Thank you.
Any more questions? I think it was an exciting session and interesting afternoon, followed by a good panel discussion steered and moderated by Danish. So, ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause. And I'll request Manish ji to present small bouquets and gifts to our eminent speakers on the dais.